Hello, and welcome back to Esoteric Freemasonry Unveiled. This is Who is Hiram Abiff? The character we know as Hiram Abiff is in all actuality not the original, nor is it the only name that our most worshipful Grand Master is known by. Albert Mackey, in his Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, gives us a place to begin. On page 329, it says Hiram, or Huram, meaning noble-born. The more correct pronunciation, according to the true value of the Hebrew letters, is Kuram, or Kurum, but universal Masonic usage renders it now impossible, or at least inexpedient, to make the change. Albert Pike, in his Morals and Dogma, tells us that Kurum, therefore improperly called Hiram, is Kur-Om, the same as Her-Ra, Hermes, and Heracles, the Heracles Tyrius Invictus, or the personification of light and of the sun. Pike continues into the etymology of the name of Hiram, or Kurum, by telling us that the name is a compound one. Kurum, meaning noble or free-born. Kur, meaning white, or noble, and also means the opening of a window or the socket of the eye. Kur is the literal name of the sun in the Parsi language. Kri also means white or an opening, and Kris, the orb of the sun. Krishna is the Hindu sun god. From Kur or Kur, the sun, comes Kora, the name of Lower Egypt, as well as a name of the sun. Plutarch tells us that the Persians called the sun Kuros. Kurios means Lord in Greek, just like Adonai in the Phoenician and Hebrew, which were also applied to the sun. The Hebrew ki means living, and with ram, meaning was or shall be raised or lifted up, making Kiram or Kiram to mean was raised up to life or living. The Egyptian deity called by the Greeks Horus was actually Her-Ra, or Har-Oris, Hor or Har, the sun. Hari is a Hindu name for the sun. Arial, Aries, Ar, Ariaman, Ariamonos, the Ar meaning fire or flame, and are of the same essential meaning. Arioris or Har-Oris, the elder Horus, is from the same root word in the Hebrew for or, A-U-R, or in the definite article prefixed, haur, light, or the light. Splendor, flame, the sun and its rays. This hieroglyphic for the younger Horus was the point within the circle, or the alchemical symbol, of the sun. Horus was the mediator who was buried 3 days, was regenerated, and triumphed over the evil principle. The word Hari in Sanskrit means shepherd, as well as savior and also Lord. Krishna is called Hari, as Jesus called himself the good shepherd. Buddha is the same as Hermes and Thoth. He is known as Herimaya or Hermaya, which are evidently the same as Hermes and Kurium and Kurum. That's Morals and Dogma, page 69. From the Egyptian Ra came the Coptic Oro and the Hebrew Aur, which means light or fire or the sun. Kuris was Adonis. Apollo, the sun god, was called Kurios from Kura, a city in Phocis. That's from Morals and Dogma. From these examples, we can clearly see that the name Hiram actually means light and also directly alludes to our physical solar orb, the sun. Let's take a look at Hiram's last name, Abiff or Abiv. In the ancient Phoenician character and in the Samaritan, AB or Ab, which are the two letters representing the numbers 1 and 2 or unity and duality, means father and is a primitive noun common to all the Semitic languages. It also means ancestor originator, inventor, head, chief or ruler, manager, overseer, master, priest, prophet. Think of all of those as being psychological states. Ab, A-B, as father, when it is in construction of a word, that is, when it precedes another word, and in English, the preposition of is interposed as abi, or of the father. The I in the word abi in the Hebrew, as the final yad, or I, means my, and by itself means my father. Abiv is the Hebrew name directly given to the fellowcraft as another name that our grandmaster was known by. The final letter being V translates as Vav, and is the possessive pronoun his. And then Abiu, which we read as Abiff, which means of my father's. The two names basically give us the son of the father, which would be an obvious choice of interpretation. But if we look at the meaning of the substitute word, we find that its meaning is the creative energy from the father. This echoes the ancient phrase of Eben Masu Habonim, or translated, the stone which the builders rejected, which is another direct allusion to the creative energy being the stone. The creative energy from the Father that resides within us all. Just as our physical body conceals our indwelling spirit, so does the phrase of Eben Masu Habonim conceal the substitute word within its letters. We see now that the ancients had many names for our solar orb, which became the crux of our mythological systems of learning for mankind. But why? From the difference between day and night to the changing of the seasons, we are constantly within a cycle of birth, life, death, and rebirth. From the birth of the sun in the east at daybreak on the horizon, to the defeat of Horus by Set as the sun sets at the end of the day, only to be reborn the next morning. The cycle of the year is identical to the cycle of the day in that it follows the path of the sun, the heavenly bodies, and the constellations. All of these astronomical bodies were personified by both positive and negative attributes that reside within us all. The Egyptian gods and goddesses were called Neters, which translates as natures. These are our inner natures, the multitude of psychological facets to our egoic selves and our inner divine natures as well. Everything is dual within the psyche, just as the multitude of gods and goddesses. They are in fact one and the same and should be viewed as such in order to acquire a deeper understanding of yourself. Pike gives us this on astrotheology. So too the struggle between the good and evil principles was personified, as was that between life and death, destruction and recreation, in allegories and fables which poetically represented the course of the sun, who, descending toward the southern hemisphere, was figuratively said to be conquered and put to death by darkness, or sunset, or the genius of evil. But, returning again toward the northern hemisphere, he seemed to be victorious and to arise from the tomb. This death and resurrection were also figurative of the succession of day and night, of death, which is a necessity of life, and of life, and the regeneration of life. Everywhere, the ancients still saw the combat between the two principles that ruled the world. Everywhere, this contest was embodied in allegories and fictitious histories, into which were ingeniously woven all the astronomical phenomena that accompanied, preceded, or followed the different movements of the sun, and the chart, the changes of seasons, the approach or withdrawal of inundation, and thus grew into stature and strange proportions the histories of the contests between Typhon and Osiris, Hercules and Juno, the Titans and Jupiter, Ormuzd and the Ahriman, the rebellious angels and deity, the evil genie and the good, and the other like fables found not only in Asia, but in the north of Europe and even among the Mexicans and Peruvians of the New World, carried thither in all probability by those Phoenician voyagers who bore their civilizations and arts. Morals and Dogma, page 453. This clearly shows the two principles and their expression in many cultures and by many names, yet clearly showing identical attributes. They all represent the consciousness of man. The phrase, as above, so below, may now have a little deeper meaning. The numerous gods and goddesses and their virtues and vices are all emblematic of the psychology of mankind. They all reside within you. Just as a side note, if we take a look at Luke 17:21, where Jesus says, "The kingdom of God is within you," this statement only confirms that the writers of the New Testament were familiar with these ideas. In the Egyptian mysteries, the nailing up of the body of Osiris in the chest, or ark, or was termed the aphanism, or disappearance, of the sun at the winter solstice, and that's what it represented, below the Tropic of Capricorn, and the recovery of the different parts of his body by Isis, the euresis, or finding. The candidate went through a ceremony representing this in all the mysteries everywhere. The main facts in the fable were the same in all countries, and the prominent deities were everywhere a male and a female. In Egypt, they were Osiris and Isis. In India, Mahadeva and Bhavanti. In Phoenicia, Tammuz and Astarte. In Phrygia, Attis and Sibyl. In Persia, Mithras and Assis. In Greece, Dionysus and Rhea. In Britain, Hugh and Ceridwen. In Scandinavia, Woden and Freya, the sun and moon. And in every instance, these divinities represent the sun and moon, Isis and Osiris. The mysteries of Osiris, Isis, and Horus seem to have been the model of all other ceremonies of initiation subsequently established among the different peoples of the world. Morals and Dogma, 290. Here, Pike is bringing the archetype of death and resurrection into the material realm in that the candidate went through a ceremony that depicted a death and resurrection identical in essence with our third degree. As an example of one of the earliest known celebrations, Pike continues to inform us that Kurum of Tyre performed what we know through a precise testimony of ancient annals of Sur, or Tyre, as the principal festival of Markarth, Malkarth, or Malkuth. Think about it. The incarnation of the sun at the winter solstice. This is pure astrotheology. This festival was celebrated on the 25th of December. Little surprise. This fact we learn from Josephus, historian. This festival was called his rebirth or his awakening and was celebrated by means of a pyre, upon which the god was supposed to regain, through the aid of fire, a new life. Under this title, Hercules, Heracles, symbolized the death and resurrection of a sun god and was annually represented at Sur by Solomon's ally, Kurum of Tyre, at the winter solstice, by the pyre of Malkarith. The worship of the Saurian Heracles, Rome celebrated its Dies Natalis Solis Invicti, the birthday of the sun, on the same day, or the Sol Invictus. Having covered Kurum and Horus and found them to be associated with the sun, let's take a look at Hermes. Hermes, or what is commonly known as Hermes Mercurius Trismegistus, is also known as the Greek Mercury and the Egyptian Tahuti, or the Greek name of Thoth may be more common to your ear. Mackey gives us this on Hermes. In all the old manuscript records which contain the legend of the craft, mention is made of Hermes as one of the founders of Freemasonry. Hermes Trismegistus, the thrice great, was celebrated as an Egyptian priest and philosopher who was said to have lived around the year 2670. Hermes was claimed by the alchemist as the founder of their art, whence it is called the Hermetic science, and whence we get in Masonry Hermetic rites and degrees. It is to him that the legend of the craft refers. That's out of Mackey's Encyclopedia from page 322. Mackey goes on to say, the hieroglyphs of Egypt and all the fables of mythology were invented to teach the dogmas of Hermetic philosophy. Mackey's Encyclopedia, page 323. All of the authorities of Freemasonry agree that Hermetic philosophy lays the foundation for what is called the operation of the sun, which is the core process within Hermetic practice and the final proof of its science. Alchemy is an inner process by which the candidate utilizes a number of practices in order to purify and align his or her egoic self with his inner divine will. This purification process is purely mental. Hermetic philosophy gives no name for deity, yet refers to deity as the All. Thoth, or Hermes, then informs us that the All is mind, and that the All is all and in all. That's a quote. The All is all and in all. That's the foundation of Hermetic belief when it comes to deity, which rings in perfect harmony with the scriptures from John, where it says, the Christ is all and in all. Identical sentence. Pike tells us this about Hermes. Nothing surpasses and nothing equals as a summary of all the doctrines of our old world those brief words engraven by Hermes on a stone and known under the name of the Tablet of Emerald, or the Emerald Tablet of Hermes, the unity of being and the unity of the harmonies, ascending and descending, the progressive and proportional scale of the word, the immutable law of the equilibrium, and the proportioned progress of the universal analogies, the relation of the idea to the word, giving the measure of mathematics of the infinite, proved by the measure of a single corner of the finite. All this is expressed by this single proposition of the great Egyptian hierophant. What is superior is as that which is inferior, and that which is below is as that which is above, to form the marvels of the unity. That's from Morals and Dogma. That's off the Emerald Tablet of Hermes. The unity is the unity of the individual with deity, or the alchemical wedding, or the sacred wedding of Christ and the Church. This unification of opposites and energies creates the proper balance that makes the candidate eligible for deeper revelations and understanding of him or herself. This Emerald Tablet consists of 10 cryptic statements that describe the process of the operation of the sun. It is proclaimed to be authored by Hiram, one in essence, three in aspect. Its instruction is intended for the adepts of an art in that, having learned the language of symbolism and allegory, they alone would be able to decipher its meaning until now. This tablet is also spoken of in Mackey's Encyclopedia under the definition of Tablet of Hiram. Remember, Hiram and Hermes are identical. It's the same thing. This tablet of Hiram, the tablets being intended simply as a symbol inculcating the duty of every man to work in the daily labor of life after a design that will construct in his body a spiritual temple. Say it again. To work daily on the construction of an inner temple or body. This process is clearly laid out in the Hermetic and alchemical texts. The alchemical wedding of Christian Rosenkreutz being one of the more recent unveilings of the ancient Christian mystery school of the Rosicrucians. Brother Paul Foster Case is an amazing resource in this area of study, and his True and Invisible Rosicrucian Order is a very informative work. I would highly recommend that book. This, my brothers, is the very essence of our work. What Paracelsus called palingenesis, or the creation of a man in a bottle, or retort, an alchemical container that represents the physical body. The man created within is the spiritual essence that already resides within the body. You will have surely heard of the Arabian fable of the genie in the bottle. Just like Aladdin's lamp, the physical body can be stimulated to release the genie within, or the spiritual essence within the container. Thus, this is and always has been the emblematic of the spirit leaving the physical body and traveling into the spiritual planes or heavens. This is also, like you already know, the meaning of the traveling in a foreign country. It's the same thing. You're traveling into the spiritual realm. The Hermetic art is, therefore, at the same time, a religion, a philosophy, and a natural science. As a religion, it is that of the ancient magi and the initiates of all ages. As a philosophy, we may find its principle in the school of Alexandria and the theories of Pythagoras. As a science, we must inquire for its processes of Paracelsus, Nicholas Flamel, and Raymond Lully. That's Morals and Dogma, page 593. The science is a real one, only for those who admit and understand the philosophy and the religion. Its process will only succeed for the adept who has attained the sovereignty of will, for the grand agent of the operation of the sun is that force described in the symbol of Hermes, of the table of emerald. It is the universal magical power, the spiritual, fiery, motive power. It is the ode, according to the Hebrews, and the astral light, according to others. This astral light, or ode, is identical to chi, or ki, and also the Hindu prana and the Hebrew mana. This substance is the animating energy of the material realm. The ancients believed that the physical solar orb, our sun, was animated by a spiritual presence or deity, and that deity was the force behind the nurturing rays of the sun, and thus the energy that resides within our atmosphere that animates all life. This teaching is key to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or holy breath. Hermes is the central and balanced being at the center of the circle, just as Mercury is known as the planet of balance. He is the traveler between the gods, carrying messages between the gods, and in his Egyptian form of Thoth, representing thought, our minds carry messages and our reason judges and decides with balanced will. When we pray, it is our thoughts that are being messengered to our deity within the sanctum sanctorum of our minds. It is our indwelling spirit that is represented by Hermes. You are Hermes. This may be the reason that we see some of the southern jurisdiction brothers who address each other as Brother Hiram. It is a clear recognition of each brother's inherent divinity and his spiritual essence, while also confirming the recognition of our spiritual selves as being Hiram or Hermes. This spiritual essence of each one of us is what connects us, We are all brothers of the same Father. The brotherhood of man under the fatherhood of God. The Emerald Table is our spiritual trestle board that points the way to true spiritual liberation. Pike leaves us with this. He who desires to attain to the understanding of the grand word and the possession of the great secret ought carefully to read the Hermetic philosophers and will undoubtedly attain initiation as others have done. But he must take, for the key of their allegories, the single dogma of Hermes contained in this Table of Emerald, Morals and Dogma, page 595. And just a few sentences later, Pike tells us that Hermetic science, like all material mathematics, are as rigorous as that of a correct equation, like a mathematical proof. So, brothers Hiram, welcome to a new way of perceiving yourself and your brothers as well, hopefully. Learning to perceive ourselves as spiritual beings having a human experience takes a little bit of openness of mind. We commonly think of ourselves as being our name and what we do for work and hobbies and the outer obligations that we must perform while alive and living a modern life. I charge you all to go forward with the spiritual sight in that you begin to see everyone as having the same indwelling deity within them as you yourself have, for the Christ is all and within all. The writings of Albert Pike point directly to the Emerald Tablet, the philosophy of Hermes, as being the foundation to Freemasonry. He makes it clear that we are a spiritual brotherhood under the same divine parentage, and that Freemasonry lays out the path to enlightenment and liberation. And as Pike said, its results, even material, are as rigorous as that of a correct equation. This man's giving us a mathematical proof and telling us, just blatantly saying, here it is, you can only prove this to be true and correct. For Esoteric Freemasonry Unveiled, I'm Jeremiah Waterchild. Blessed be, and have a great summer.